Glad I'm saved, amen. Justified, declared righteous as if I never sinned and were never a sinner. What a joy it is to be here. Thank you, Pastor Raven and Brother Phil. Thank you so much for allowing me to come and for the invitation and for providing somewhere for me to stay and for the opportunity to minister the Word of God. We're privileged to serve the Lord. It is a privilege. It's an honor and to have the opportunity to go different places and to do what we love to do. I'm so thankful for it. And I'm thankful for conferences like this. Young people, you have a responsibility to live for God, but thank God for the people that want to help you do it. And I'm thankful for youth pastors and conferences. I'm for all of them that are trying to challenge young people to honor God, live for God, and to make a difference. This world is a horrible place. It'll chew you up and spit you out. But our God can use you. And I certainly thank the Lord for the opportunity and the safety. My nephew Cameron and Cephas, young men in our church, they're here tonight, and we thank the Lord for the opportunity of their coming with me. And we're excited about what God's going to do. I appreciate the message we've heard already. Looking forward to what God's going to do in the days ahead. Mark chapter number 5, if you have your Bibles today, it's good to see a number of friends. I appreciate the young men singing, and certainly thank the Lord for the ministry of West Coast and Lancaster Baptist Church, and thank God for their training people for the work of the ministry. Good to see Dr. and Mrs. Weaver. Good to see you, dear folks. Special people to us, and we're glad to see you all. Trust that God is continuing to watch and take good care of you. Mark chapter 5, if you'll stand to your feet with me for the reading of God's word, the Gospel of Mark chapter number 5. The Bible says in verse number 21, and when Jesus was passed over again by ship, and on the other side, much people gathered unto him. He was nigh unto the sea. Behold, there cometh one of the rulers of the synagogue, Jairus by name. And when he saw him, he fell at his feet. Besought him greatly, saying, my little daughter lieth at the point of death. I pray thee, come and lay thy hands on her that she may be healed. She shall live. Jesus went with him, and much people followed him and thronged him. And a certain woman which had an issue of blood 12 years and had suffered many things and many physicians and had spent all that she had and was nothing bettered but rather grew worse, when she heard of Jesus, came in the press behind and touched his garment. For she said, if I may touch but his clothes, I shall be whole. And straightway the fountain of her blood was dried up. She felt in her body that she was healed of that plague. And immediately knowing in himself the virtue had gone out of him, turned him about in the press and said, who touched my clothes? And his disciples said unto him, thou seest multitude thronging thee, and sayest thou, who touched me? And he looked round about to see that had done this thing, but the woman fearing and trembling, knowing what was done in her, came and fell down before him and told him all the truth. He said unto her, daughter, thy faith made thee whole. Go. Notice, go in peace and be whole of thy plague. Our Father, we ask for your help these next few moments. I pray, Lord, that you cleanse me of sin, empty me of self, and fill me with your spirit. Help me to be a blessing. I do pray, Lord, that you will speak to the heart of every young person, adult alike. God, we need to be different. You're the only one that can change us. And I pray today that you'd make a difference in our lives, not just for today, but for eternity. I pray that you bind Satan, put a hedge of protection about this place, that in no way you'd hinder the work of the Holy Spirit of God. Use me to do what you can through me so that you get the glory through all that is said and done. Bless my wife and children back home while I'm gone. In Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you so much for standing. At the beginning of this chapter, the Bible says Lord Jesus Christ came into the country of the Gadarenes. He is met by what we've come to know, the Gadarene demoniac. Imagine this man is possessed, controlled, and influenced by demons. We learn later that his name is Legion, so he's not just possessed by a demon, he's possessed by many demons. So much to the point that his behavior is erratic. It cannot be constrained. Listen how crazy he was. He's running in and out of the cemetery. And I'm going to tell you right now, anybody that runs in and out of the cemetery is crazy. Then the Bible tells us he's naked. Now, to be naked is crazy. It's become popular, but it's crazy, all right? So he is running in and out of cemeteries, and he's naked. He's cutting himself up. They chain him. He gets loose. All of a sudden, they see this crazy man. He's a menace to society. Everybody thinks he's crazy. Nobody can do anything with him. He's hanging out in lunatic places. He's controlled by demons. He can't do anything with his life, even though he wants to. They can't fix him, even though they want to. Nothing good seems to come out of his life, even though they wanted to. And this is his condition. Until one day, he saw Jesus. I'd like to pause there just a moment. You know, there's potential for change in your life when you see Jesus. Jesus all of a sudden was what he laid his eyes on. And the Bible said when he saw Jesus, verse number 6, he ran and worshiped him. Now, he didn't worship like a believer could worship him who'd been changed or saved, but he worshiped him out of respect. He knew that there was something different about this man, and he fell down on his feet. Notice what he said: "What have I to do with thee, Jesus, thou Son of the Most High God?" This is not the message, but I want you to notice that this man possessed with demons, an absolute lunatic, ran up to Jesus, and in his out of mind state, he still knew Jesus was the Son of God. Amen. We live in a day and age where people are questioning the deity of Christ. And I find it amazing that this man had a crazy life, but he knew who Jesus was. Jesus, thou Son of the Most High God, and he falls down before the Lord. To make a long story short, Jesus cast the demons out of this man and sends them into the swine. And the next time these people in town see this man that was once naked, that was once crazy, that was once running around, the Bible says he is sitting, he is clothed, and in his right mind, and it is proof that Jesus changes lives. After this, Jesus is met by somebody else. Jairus is different than this demoniac. Jairus is a man of clout. He's a ruler of the synagogue. He's got money, prestige. He's got prominence. He's popular. Man, he's somebody that everybody knows. He's got a problem. He's got a 12-year-old daughter that's lying in her bed at the point of death. He needs help. And he needs help fast. He needs something special. He needs something real. He needs something that's not normal. Guess who Jairus came looking for? Jesus. He came begging Jesus, "Oh, come to my house. Oh, come to my house and heal my daughter. She's getting ready to die." Can you imagine the burden on this daddy's heart as his 12-year-old girl is on the brink of death? It seems hopeless, but he comes to meet Jesus. And Jesus, being the compassionate man that he was, immediately agreed to go to Jairus' house, and off they headed that way. But on the way to Jairus' house, Jesus is met by a third person. This is not a demoniac, and this is not a man with a 12-year-old girl, but this is a woman with a 12-year-old problem. She's got an issue of blood. She's hemorrhaging at the point that it's getting worse and worse, and nothing seemed to work. Guess who this woman came to meet? The Lord Jesus Christ. She came begging, she came looking, she came searching. Now, the amazing thing about this story is she didn't show up to Jesus with a personal appointment. She didn't show up to Jesus with a prior arrangement. She didn't show up to Jesus with a solo encounter. She didn't show up to Jesus with him expecting to evaluate or analyze her all by herself. She showed up with Jesus on a day when crowds gathered around the Lord, when crowds thronged around the Lord. You see, this was not a private time designated for her. You see, many were looking for Jesus that day. But I want you to notice what the scripture says in verse 27. It says she came in the press behind. She came in the press behind. I take that to mean this. She couldn't get to him easy. There was no access that was simple. There was no red carpet. There was no Jesus standing there going, hey, where's that lady I came here to see? Step forward. No, he was surrounded. There were obstacles. Hey, there was plenty of reason for her to turn around and go back. Hey, there were plenty of reasons for her to say, I'll never get there. Hey, there was plenty of logic to say, this is a waste of time. Hey, there was plenty of reasoning in her mind to go, there's no way that I'll get to this man. But I'll tell you something, there was something in her that said, I'll not settle until I'll get there. I'll not stop until I arrive. I'll not allow myself to tolerate just showing up and not actually meeting him. You see, you got to understand something, young people. To her, Jesus wasn't just anybody. To her, Jesus wasn't just a celebrity. To her, Jesus wasn't some politician. To her, Jesus wasn't some athlete. To her, Jesus wasn't some rich man. You see, to her, Jesus was her hero. You see, he was somebody that could change her life, that could make a difference, you see. And when she showed up that day, she would not let the crowds, she would not let the people, she would not let the multitudes, she would not let the obstacles deter her from getting to Jesus. You know why? She had an issue. She had an issue, and there was nobody that could solve her issue other than the Lord Jesus Christ. And I'd like to say today, having preached to a number of young people and with teenagers in my church and teenagers all over this world, showcased on television and internet and everywhere you can think of, some of you are going to have to line up today and just make sense of the matter. You got some issues. You got some issues. Hey, and listen, it doesn't take us long to figure out we got young people with issues. 3 out of 4 young people, seniors, graduate without their virginity. 20% of 15-year-olds have had sex by the time they turn 15. Listen, that's an issue. You saw these statistics today about suicide and depression and drugs. That's an issue. It's a problem when you need parental consent for an aspirin, but not for a condom. That's an issue. It's a problem when the average teenager spends 11 hours and 23 minutes a day on some form of social media. That's an issue. It's a problem when you're addicted to Facebook, but your face is not in the book. That's an issue. It's a problem when you can't pray. It's a problem when you got a dirty mouth. It's a problem when you're hooked on porn. It's a problem when your rap CDs and your rock CDs and your R&B CDs and your things on Instagram and your tweets dishonor God. It's a problem when you disrespect your parents. It's a problem when you fool around with alcohol. It's a problem when you got a bad attitude. It's a problem when you don't want to come to church. It's a problem when your pants are sagging off your backside. It's a problem when you're dressing like you're trying to sell your body. It's a problem when you grow up in church and never come back after you graduate. That's an issue. I'd like to tell you about my hero. He's in the business of fixing issues. He's in the business of solving problems. He's in the business of changing lives. And would to God it be somebody, some boy, or some girl who showed up at this Mid-Atlantic Youth Conference this week and said, I don't care who's around him. I don't care what I've got to go through. I don't care what line I got to stand in. I don't care how long I got to wait. I need to get to my hero. I'll not let anything stop me. I'll not let anybody block me. I'll not let anything slow me down. Why? Because the only one that can fix my issue is Jesus. And I'm going to press through the crowd. See, if you're ever going to be a hero, you better make sure you meet the hero. And there is no superhero like Jesus. Amen. He don't need a belt. He don't need a cape. He don't need a wand. He don't need a mask. He don't need a disguise. He can do fine all by himself. Amen. He's all powerful, all knowing, omnipresent, unchangeable, eternal. Listen to me. He's God and God alone. Listen to me. The devil can't stop him. And listen to me. The world can't wipe him out. He is Jesus. He is our superhero. And he has power to heal you. He has power to change you. He has power to use you. He has power to anoint you. He has power to revive you, chastise you. He has power to make something out of you when the world says you can be nothing. How determined are you? How determined are you? She pressed through the crowd. Look at this story in Mark chapter 5. Notice a couple things about this woman. She pressed through the crowd. First of all, she was conscious of his activity. Conscious of his activity. Look at verse 27. When she had, what's the next word? You ain't looking at your Bible. Verse 27, when she had Come on, look at your Bibles. Talk to me. When she had, don't take my word for it. Look at your Bible. When she had heard, I tell our people all the time, I'm the pastor, but that don't mean anything. Look at your Bible. When she had heard of Jesus. You know what that means? Boy, she'd been checking up on him. She had done her homework. Listen. You, when you got an issue of blood, you don't leave the house and crawl all the way down there unless you know that whoever's there got it going on. Let me tell you something. She heard of Jesus. Now listen. Bible doesn't tell us all she heard, but let me speculate. Maybe she had heard withered hands get restored. Maybe she had heard storms get calm. Maybe she had heard deaf men start to hearing, dumb men start to talking, lame men start to walking, blind men start to seeing, lepers get cleansed, and debtors get forgiven. I don't know what she heard, but she heard enough to get away down there that day. She'd been looking, she'd been longing, she'd been learning. Listen to me, no wonder she showed up that day. Now, wait a minute now. I'm glad to be at this Mid-Atlantic Youth Conference. I'm going to see preachers that I know, two of my friends. I get a chance to spend a little bit of time with. We don't get to see each other often. I'm glad to see young people. Listen to me. I thank God for all these decorations. What a wonderful job the church here at Beacon has done in setting up a conference for you and the games and the food. How many of you thank God for conferences that have food? Can I get an amen? All right, so right about now, I'm hungry. It's good to put me before the meal time. I'm normally a long-winded preacher, but I'm hungry. All right, so we can try to get our way through the message, and I'm glad for food, and I'm glad for decorations, and I'm glad for fun, and I'm glad for games, and I'm glad for marshmallows. Well, I think so. I'm glad for all of those things. But let me tell you something. What makes this conference spectacular is not the games, not the food, not the preachers, not the lineup, not the building, not the facilities. Not all of the prizes, not even, listen, not the music. What makes this conference spectacular is that Jesus is in town, right down in Raleigh, North Carolina. Extra, read all about it. It may not come on the news tonight. It may not show up on SportsCenter tonight, but I want every boy and girl to sit up during this conference, not because I'm preaching, Brother Dave's preaching, or Brother Ray's preaching, but because Jesus is in town. And as long as he's here, listen to me, withered hands can get restored, drunkards can sober up, liars can tell the truth. Some of you boys that have wasted your life chasing a wrong relationship and fooled around with the mess of the world. Hey, sit up. I wouldn't sleep during church. I wouldn't fool around on my phone during church. I wouldn't let myself be distracted during church. After all, Jesus is in town. Wow, she heard. I'm going. Why? Because that man changed his life. Hey, you better be glad you're here. Because Jesus is in town. She was conscious of his activity. Notice number two. Look what verse number 26 says. And has suffered many things, many physicians, and had spent all she had, and was nothing better, but rather grew worse. Now, number one, she was conscious of his activity. Number two, she had completed all other alternatives. Now watch this. She had tried it all and nothing had worked. She had been to the doctor. She'd gone through the procedures. She was at her wit's end. Everything humanly possible, she had tried, and not only was she not better, she was worse. You know why you need to press through the crowd tonight? Because nothing else you've tried has worked. And let me tell you something. We're in a day and age of some trying teenagers. And by trying, I mean they'll try anything. Did you see the boy just a few minutes ago? Two marshmallows were in a trash can. And the preacher said, "You want to eat it?" The boy ate it. You say, "What? Well, that's stupid." That's what I'm saying. But these teenagers, they do that kind of stuff. We don't know where that trash can been. That boy might be dead tomorrow. But he died trying. McDonald's put out a nasty sandwich. Kids try it. Jordan put out some $200 shoes. They buy it and they shoot each other over it. Listen, I'm from Washington, D.C. They shoot people over Jordans. I don't want no Jordans. I ain't trying to get shot over no shoes. Amen. It ain't worth it. Man, they line up for hours upon hours to get a pair of Jordans. And then they sell it on the internet. That's stupid. But they'll try it. Now I'm trying to figure out. I'm trying to figure out why McDonald's has a nasty sandwich, you'll try it. Why Michael Jordan puts out expensive shoes and you'll try it. And why Jesus is in town and you won't try it. Somebody explain something to me. Somebody explain to me why the Muslim is facing Mecca 5 times a day and worshiping a God that cannot hear him, and the Christian won't pray to Jesus. Somebody explain to me why the Buddhist is praying to Buddha when the Lord Jesus Christ is alive and rules and reigns. Somebody tell me why some Hindu is saying, "Grandma, I miss you," to some cow that says moo when my Savior's alive and he rules and he reigns. Trying drugs and trying alcohol and trying sex. Somebody will try Jesus today. He's our hero. He's got a track record. He's never failed. He's never had a case he had to turn down or a person he could not heal. My soul. She completed all of the alternatives. Number 3. She was committed to accessing. For she said, 28, "If I may touch but his clothes." Wow. If I could just get there. Despite her pain, despite her prior attempts, despite the perception, the Old Testament said to have an issue of blood was not well received. You were put away. It was a disgrace. For the woman to have what she had was a disgrace. But she showed up that day and said, "Fooling with what people think about me. I got an issue." You know what? Some of you are going to lose your pride this conference. Or I'd go down to that altar and get right. But my boys on the pew with me going to know I was wrong if I go to get right. Listen, I'd get right with God, but how am I going to do that and keep my relationship with my girlfriend? I'd get right with God, but everybody thinks I'm cool and the youth group won't think I'm soft if I go down there and shed tears about the sin I'm involved. Oh, I'd carry my Bible in school, but my jock friends won't really think I'm cool if I've got my Bible. Oh, I'd stand up against that rap music and I'd tell them to hush those dirty jokes, but I don't want to lose my status with my, let me tell you something, I'd rather lose status and gain healing any day of the week. There are kids today who haven't gotten right with God because they worry about what somebody will think. Teenagers say all the time, I can't get rid of those friends. We ain't grown up together. We've hung out together. We've been friends for years. I couldn't imagine not being friends anymore. Let me tell you something. You start living for God, you won't have to get rid of them. They'll get rid of you. Amen. Some of you just determined, "I'm going to get Jesus." You won't have to tell them not to be your friend anymore. They'll leave you. Amen. And you know what I found out? When they leave you because of your relationship with God, God will give you some real friends. She determined by the grace of God, "I'm not going to let these perceptions and this pain." Sources say she probably didn't walk that day. She probably crawled. Her issue of blood in my mind was so strong and so tough that she probably couldn't even walk. But guess what? Despite how much pain and with every movement of her body, no doubt my mind, it hurt her to get there. But she said, "No matter how much pain it cost me, I got to get there." Number 4, she was confident in his ability. "I shall be made whole." I tell our young people, if you don't believe God will, don't worry, he won't. Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Amen. He that cometh to God must believe that he is. That's right. I said you must believe that he is. Amen. But see, before you ever believe in what God can do, you got to believe in who God is. He that cometh to God must believe that he is. That is a reward of them that diligently seek him. Listen to me. She made up her mind. If I get to that spot, listen to me, he's going to heal me. I'd like to see a kid with some passion come down the altar this week and know that burdens are lifted at Calvary and know that God can change my life and know that as bad as my 2013 was, God can do something different in 2014. You know why we don't get anything from God? We don't believe that God is, that God has anything for us. Listen to me. I've tried him. I've tested him. I've experienced him. I know that he's able. I know that he's real. I know that he changes lives. It's nothing like a pastor seeing young people test God and try God. Listen to me. You can't live for God through your mom and your dad and your youth pastor and your friends. You can't live for God through your Christian school and through what your church believes. There'll come a day where your relationship with God will be tested for itself. You may make it through that Christian school as a senior, but when you leave that school and go to that college as an adult and that secular teacher puts glasses down on the bottom of his nose and dandruff on his jacket and tells you some tadpole climbed out the water and turned into some monkey and turned into some human being, and you look down the way at one of your classroom, you're one of your classmates that resembles a monkey, and you said, maybe it might be true. I'm trying to tell you, evolution ain't true. God took from the dust of the ground, formed man and breathed into man's nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. And you ain't been to Jesus for yourself. What are you going to do when they question you? She's confident. If I get to the right place, right person, he'll take me through the right process. I'll have the right product. I'll be whole. Do you believe it? But Pastor, you don't know my issue. Do you know my God? You don't know my year. Oh, do you know his eternity? You know what I'm dealing with. You know what he's handled. You know how far down I am. Listen to you. Do you know how far up he is? You got to believe it. I'm almost finished. She was cured of her affliction. She touched his garment. By the way, you look at this passage of scripture, all three of these individuals found what they needed at the same place. The Gadarene demoniac. Jairus. Amen. This woman with the issue of blood. And by the way, you'll find what you need at the same place. You say, where is it? At the feet of Jesus. Amen. You got to get down before he ever pulls you up. Straightway, good night alive. She'd been to all them doctors. They couldn't do nothing with her. And she touched his garment. The Bible says straightway. You know what that means? Instantaneously. You know what I love about Jesus? It doesn't take him a long time to do what he does. Amen. Amen. There's some of you kids but will spend 5 years trying to get to the NBA and won't even make Pee Wee League. And listen, I'm not preaching on this, but some of you fellas, if you quit chasing a dead dream and surrender to the call to preach, you'd find out you'd have a better time living for Jesus than you would ever trying to make something of your own self. Let me tell you something. Straightway, 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 the moment she touched the hem of his garment, instantaneously, not only instantaneously, infallibly. You know what that meant? What God took out of her was never coming back. Inexplicably, that means you could not explain it. Indubitably, that means there was no doubt about it. Inwardly, that means not just the outside, but the inside was healed. And I'm telling you, when Christ does it, he does it all the way. I laugh at these. These new medicines that come out on television. You watch these people trying these new pills. Cymbalta. And they talk about how sick they were. And all of a sudden they discovered Cymbalta and their life is so great. And you see the husband and the wife and the little puppy dog walking down the beach, skipping together. You see two people riding a bicycle. Life is a breeze now. I could just fly like an eagle. You know what I mean? And you just see them just walking down there, and the little kids all dressed up perfectly, walking through the sand on the beach. And all of the credit for their happy life was due to that one little pill of Cymbalta. And then you get to the end of the commercial, and a little voice comes on and says, possible side effects, heart attack, stroke, AIDS, diabetes, dementia, high blood pressure, AIDS, arthritis, stroke, headache, loss of mind, loss of salvation. Let me tell you something. Any pill that does one good thing for me and 10 bad things for me, I don't want to make. You know what I'm glad? I'm glad the day that Jesus saved me, he saved me with zero side effects. I'm glad that the day he saved me, there's not one sin that he covered that pops back up and condemns me. There's not one spot on me that he cleansed that has popped back up and doomed me. There's not been one day, despite my sin, and I sin every day, there's not been one day, despite my failures, and I've failed in plenty of times. There's not been one day, despite my mistakes, and I've got more than you could count. There's not been one day. day despite my weaknesses. And I've got plenty of weaknesses, but there's not been one day that my weaknesses, my mistakes, my failures, and all my inadequacies have sent me to hell. I've woke up every day with my name still written in the Lamb's Book of Life, with my inheritance incorruptible, still waiting upon my revival, upon my arrival. I wake up every day still kept by the power unto the day of redemption. You know why? I've been saved by the grace of God through faith in it, not of myself. It's the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. And the day that I got in Christ, I became a new creature. All things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Muhammad can't do that. Buddha can't do that. The Pope can't do that. Nobody else can do that. But Jesus can. I feel a preaching storm coming up right about now. I'm trying to tell you, you don't need Cymbalta, you need Jesus. She was cured. And then after he heals her, the Bible said, knowing in him that virtue had gone out of him, he turned about and said, who touched me? And you know those keen disciples were rather often on the wrong page. John chapter 4, my meat is to do the will of him that sent me. They're looking for a ham sandwich. Yeah. That ain't the kind of meat I'm talking about. They were off. Who touched me? They're thinking to themselves, who didn't touch you? Like we say, everybody touched you. Wait a minute, Jesus said, this was a touch of faith. See, watch this now. Well, hear me well. If something happens in your life in the next couple of days, it ain't going to be because you bumped into Jesus on accident. It's going to be because you touched him on purpose. You know the problem with the average kid? I'm closing. My church said you're always closing, but you never close. But anyway, you know the problem with the average teenager? We've been around him so much, we're used to bumping into him. Some of you kids could write the order of service. Huh? But there's no order of service in your life. You understand? You could rattle off more scriptures than your pastor could. But the problem is you carry your Bible, but your Bible don't carry you. See, you're used to singing the songs. And listen, I'm all for teen choirs, but good gracious alive. If the only time those words come alive are when you sing them and not when you're not singing them, you might as well sit down somewhere. Amen. God bless you kids that can preach in competition, but your sermon ought to be in shoes every day you walk. Amen. Somebody help me preach. I'm trying to tell you that God is looking for some people that can demonstrate Jesus, and it takes some passion. Somebody's going to touch Jesus on purpose. Hey, listen, you don't have to get about your seat this week and forget about who's sitting beside you. I'm going to touch him. I don't want to leave the conference and say, yeah, he was here. He bumped me. Yeah, I bumped. No. I want to say, I got up and I touched him on purpose. A touch of faith. Jesus said, you touch me with faith. Virtue will come out of me. Who touched me? Can you see Jesus looking around? Who was it? Who touched me? By the way, this is for free. Jesus never asked a question because he didn't know the answer.
Come on, that's right.
Who touched me? You think he's going, all right now. Come out wherever you are. I know it was one of y'all. Get the fingerprint machine, Peter. No. Adam, yeah. Where art thou? Yeah. Right. Hey, Adam, where art thou? Can you see the huddle in heaven? God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. God the Father said, all right, Jesus, you go that way. Holy Ghost, you go that way. I'm going this way. And an hour later, came back and said, we don't know where Adam is. Do you really think that's what happened?
Come on.
You don't think God knew where Adam was? God didn't ask the question for his own benefit. He asked the question for Adam's benefit. You can run, but you can't hide, bucko. Simon Peter, lovest thou me? You think Jesus crossing his fingers like a boy asked a girl on the first date? I hope he loves me. What I'm going to say if Pete says no? Study your Bible. He was differentiating true love with affection. Do you love me or you just have little tingly feelings for me when I treat you good?
Hello.
Huh? He never never asked the question because he didn't know the answer. After 5,000 people ate catfish and cornbread, John chapter 6. You say, how you know it was catfish and cornbread? Because Jesus always gives the best stuff. If he'd hand out fish and bread, it was catfish and cornbread. And the disciples were passing out hot sauce and tartar sauce on the side. And for some of you black folk, ketchup. Amen. And sweet tea, it just didn't make the canon. I'm joking. And after all 5,000 of them ate, beside women and children, sources say could have been somewhere between 15 and 20,000. He then turned to them while they were licking their lips from what they just ate and said, you thought that meal was good. Look at here, I'm the bread of life. John 6:6:6, read your Bible. Many of them walked away that day. This is a hard saying. Then he turned to the 12. Will you also go away? Kenny Baldwin paraphrased. Y'all boys leaving too? You think he didn't know the answer? No, he wanted to get them thinking. Thinking. I'm not here just to pay your bills and feed your meals. I'm here to be your everything. They left because they only wanted what I had for them. You better stay because you want me. Who touched me? You know what he's saying, girl? I changed your life. You gonna dip out of here without thanking me? That's not in there, but it's, I'm preaching this message. And the Bible said, fearing and trembling, she came forward. Hey, you know what the Lord is saying at this Mid-Atlantic Youth Conference? Did anybody get something from Jesus that you couldn't get from anybody else? A whole bunch of us. Well, it's time to step up and testify. Amen. I did. Oh, I'd like to have been, that was a church service. I'd have liked to have been at that church service. Impromptu, off the chart, not on the schedule, testimony time. Go on, girl, stand up. The disciples might think, she wasn't on the schedule. Hush, she got something to say. Speak, sister. Yes, I'd have loved to have been to hear her share her testimony. If you had known how bad my life's been the last 12 years, yeah, listen, I could bring you a record of all the doctor's appointments I've been to. Listen, I could tell you all the prescriptions. I got prescriptions gone at home in my medicine cabinet. I've tried all of them, and nothing's gotten better. As a matter of fact, I'm getting worse and worse and worse. You know, I battle in my mind whether I even make the trip down here today. But I'd heard that this man does big things. I crawled my way down. I've been spat on. I've been kicked at. I've been smirked at. I've been hated on. I've been had some mean things said to me. But I want you to know, just a few moments ago, I finally arrived at the place I planned on going this morning, and I reached at the very hem of his garment. But if you could have felt what I felt the moment I touched him, that 12-year-old problem was gone, gone, gone. She's testifying. And while she's testifying, Jairus is listening. Listening like this. Lord, I asked first. You said you're coming to my house. What daddy in here wouldn't be rushing Jesus right about now? And Jesus, in my mind, I'm thinking, he got the nerve to stop for this woman with 12-year-old problem. If she didn't die after 12 years, 12 years and a few more hours ain't gonna kill her. My daughter about to die. I mean, even the emergency room take the bigger emergencies first. He didn't just stop. He didn't stop because he forgot about Jairus. He stopped because Jairus needed to hear this woman's testimony. And if he's done something in your life, somebody at this conference needs to hear yours. No doubt in my mind, when he heard what she said, God built his faith to know if he did that for her, he can do that for me. Listen to me. When you press through the crowd, you get a testimony. And when you share a testimony, you help somebody. And people need help. All of us do. Years ago, we were having a youth activity at our church, and we were going to the, I don't remember what it was called then. It's the MCI Center now, but where the Washington Bullets played. They were the Bullets then. They changed the name from Bullets because Bullets was offensive, and now it's Wizards. Go figure. But anyway, the Bullets were playing the Bulls. Now, most of you don't never know anybody play for the Bullets, but everybody know who played for the Bulls. Michael Jordan, best player to ever play the game. And he showed up. I know y'all think LeBron is, whatever. All right, but anyway. So we had Brother Phil kids show up that youth activity that hadn't been to church in months. Hey, what's your name again? Oh, I'm a member here. I don't know you. That's all right, Jordan's in town. I'm going to see him. The bus was packed, loaded up. We had 3 and 4 on one seat. Hot. You add hot with a bunch of black kids and it gets to be hotter, all right? Because dark colors absorb heat. So here we are. Now, and then you got teenagers. So now you're hotter and stinking, all right? So we all on this bus. The kids don't use deodorant. They're trying to be cool. I'm glad when we came up that it was cool to smell good. Things have changed now. You stank, you cool. Hey, what's up with you? You want to know if he's cool? Go smell him. He stank. Oh, he's cool. But anyway, in my book, stank is never going to be cool. But anyway, so we get to the game, and of course, the Bulls crush the Bullets. And seats are starting to be vacated because the Bullets being the home team, obviously people know it's no use in staying. So it's time to leave. So as seats are vacated, we're sitting in these real nosebleed seats way up top. And so as good seats were being vacated, I slid my way down, little by little. You got to be smooth about it. There's one thing about growing up in the ministry, you learn how to be smooth. So I'm moving my way down, moving my way down, moving my way down, moving my, until I end up at the bottom, almost on the floor. And the clock is winding down, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. And the buzzer goes off, and all of a sudden, they're giving each other 5 and dapping up and whatever. And so they're walking off the court, and the Bullets exit, and then here come the Bulls. All the Bulls players walking off the court. I didn't care about none of them, but that one right there, all of a sudden, he started walking towards me. My heart started beating. He got closer, closer, closer. And then I saw it. I saw it myself. Scintillating in the lights. His sweaty bald head coming towards me. I felt the spirit moving. And then Michael Jordan looked up at me. And I looked down at him. I was about from here. I'm serious. About from here to this. I'm not lying right now. I'm preaching. Listen. I looked down at him and he looked up at me. Him and me. Me and him. And in that moment, eye to eye, face to face. Me and Mike. You know what I did? No, I'm sorry, I didn't do that. I didn't blow a kiss. I didn't do that. But I held my hand out and said, Mike! Give me 5! I was reaching over the rail. Mike! 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 He saw me. He looked at me. And kept walking. I said that bald-headed Negro kept walking past me. I thought years later, kids didn't come to church, showed up at activity. The pastor's son sat down in a seat that wasn't his to get close to reach out and touch Mike. And Jesus makes himself available to us every day, and we won't touch him. Shame on us. He made Mike. All things were created by him and for him, and by him all things do consist. And moreover, not only is he available for us to reach out and touch him, he's reaching out to touch us. Whatever it takes in the next few days, don't have Jesus come to this conference and you miss him. Because if you do, you have no one to blame but yourself. Our Father, we thank you for your blessed word. God, how many times we've missed out an opportunity to press through the crowd and get close to you. I don't know what every kid's going through today, but I know young people have issues. And you're in the business of solving issues. Oh, God, I hope you do it today. Heads bowed, eyes closed, no one looking around. I wonder how many of you say, Pastor Kenny, I know if I died today that I'd go to heaven. I know that. Would you raise your hand? I know I'm saved. I have Bible readings to prove it. I know I'm saved. God bless you. Let me put your hands down. If you know you're saved, let me ask you this. But I've got some issues. I've got some issues in my life that need to be solved. Jesus needs to do some changing in my life today. I'm not talking about anybody else. I'm talking about you. It may be what you call big or what you call small. Regardless, I have some issues that I need Jesus to change. And I want to get to him this week. If that's you, would you raise your hand? Look at there. Hands all over. In a moment, I hope every one of you get up and come to the altar and do business with God. That's what it's all about. If you're not saved today, you ought to come and let somebody show you. We'll have a more directed invitation perhaps later on this evening for those who are lost. But don't wait till this evening if you know you're not saved. Come find somebody. Get it right. Let's stand together. Lord, would you bless this invitation time and move like only you can. Make a difference for Christ's sake. In Jesus' name. Amen. Now look at it, just a moment. We've laughed and joked and had a good time, I hope. But this is serious business. If you put your hand up as a young person, said, I've got some issues all over the room, they need to get right. Listen, let's not play games with God right now. Come on, come on. Find your place on the altar. Mind the Lord. Come on, you put your hand up. Let's obey the Lord. Don't wait, don't wait, don't wait. Don't fool around. Come on, shovel your others. You put your hand up. I've got some issues that need change. I've got some issues that need change. Let's mind the Lord. Come on, come as far as you can and kneel in the aisle if you need to. Yes, come all the way up, would you? There are people behind you. Yes. Others of you, put your hand up. Don't wait. Mind the Lord. Mind the Lord. I surrender all. I surrender all. To thee. My blessings. Blessed Savior, I surrender. This big conference, a lot of kids here. Listen, listen. You go to Jesus like you're the only one here. You don't have time to worry about what everybody's doing. You can. Mind the Lord. Obey him. And do business with him. And listen, touch him in faith. Mean it. Believe. He can change. Believe he can fix your issue. Put the rest in his hands.